हेलो एवरीवन, टुडेज टॉपिक इज़ विजुअल पाथवे, स्पेसिफिक लर्निंग ऑब्जेक्टिव्स फॉर टुडेज लेक्चर आर टू नो अबाउट विजुअल पाथवेज, टू नो अबाउट इफेक्ट ऑफ लीजन ऑफ विजुअल पाथवे एंड टू नो अबाउट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन एंड फंक्शंस ऑफ विजुअल कॉर्टेक्स। सो फर्स्ट वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट द विजुअल पाथवे। Now, visual pathway is the neural pathway which transmit the signal from retina up to the visual cortex. The visual cortex is the area of cerebral cortex which is situated in the cerebral hemisphere. You are very well aware about the retina. We have already discussed the different neural layer of retina. So the nerve fiber, which is actually axons of ganglion cells, they transmit the signal through the various part of the nervous system and reach up to the visual cortex. Okay, this includes the visual pathway. So now first we start from the retina. So from retina, the retina having a two half. If we draw a one vertical line at the fovea centralis, then we divide the retina into two half, temporal half and nasal half. The medial side of the retina is known as the nasal half, the lateral side is known as the temporal half. So we have actually two type of fiber, temporal fiber as well as nasal fibers. Okay, the temporal fiber, they coming from the temporal half of the retina, nasal fiber coming from the nasal half of the retina. Okay, now they forms the optic nerve, which are actually axons of ganglion cells. The ganglion cells are the one type of neural cells of retina whose axons forms the optic nerve. Now optic nerve then form the optic chiasma. The optic chiasma is actually formed by the crossing over of nasal half of retinal fiber. Okay, the nasal half of one eye and the fiber from nasal half of opposite eye. So they both cross over at the optic chiasma. Okay, after the crossing over, whatever the bundle is formed, it contain the fiber from temporal half of the same side of the eye and the fiber from nasal half of opposite side of the eye. So that form the optic tract. Okay, so this one is the optic tract. This optic tract, it terminated on the lateral geniculate body, which is actually one of the nuclei of thalamus, because this is the sensory pathway. So most of the sensory pathway, they first relay on the thalamus before they reach up to the cortex. Okay, so thalamus is the main relay center for most of the sensory incoming fiber. So this optic tract fiber, they terminated in the lateral geniculate body. From lateral geniculate body, it make the synapse with the neurons whose axon then forms a optic radiation, and they ultimately terminated on visual cortex. Okay, so this axons of neurons whose cell body is situated in lateral geniculate body, that forms the optic radiation. Okay, and finally it terminated in the visual cortex in the occipital area, and the area where this fiber terminated, they are known as the primary visual cortex. They are situated around the calcaline fissure and they are extended up to the occipital pole. Okay, so this is visual cortex. Now we will see this in the chart form, that from retina up to the visual cortex, these are the pathway. Okay, that from retina, optic nerve, then optic chiasma, then optic tract, then lateral geniculate body, in particularly the dorsal part. Okay, because the ventral part having a same another function that we will just discuss later on. So dorsal part of lateral geniculate body, optic radiation, and then visual cortex. So this is the visual pathway. Now we see the other connection of visual pathway. There are several collaterals are there, or we can say several branches from this optic from this visual pathway. They goes in some surrounding CNS area, and they having a role in some other function. So visual fibers also pass to several older area of the brain. For example, from the optic tract to suprachiasmatic nucleus of hypothalamus, presumably to control circadian rhythm that synchronize various physiological changes of body with night and day. If you remember, in previous lecture we had also discussed about this suprachiasmatic nucleus, that in the ganglionic layer, the third type of ganglionic cells which secretes the melanopsin, this melanopsin secreting neurons, they actually going to the suprachiasmatic nuclei, and this suprachiasmatic nuclei, they control the circadian rhythm. The circadian rhythm is the changes in the various bodily function according to the timing of the day. Okay, so as the different bodily organs functions differently at daytime and differently at night time, so this type of changes is known as circadian rhythm, and this circadian rhythm is actually controlled by suprachiasmatic nucleus, and the fiber from the eye is also going to the suprachiasmatic nucleus because it determines its function according to the amount of light which enter into the eye. So this is one more function. Then the fiber, some fiber goes into the pretectal nuclei, into midbrain, to elicit reflex movement of the eye, to focus on object of importance and to activate papillary light reflex. So there are two reflex, one is the right reflex, another is the accommodation reflex. So both this reflex, they having a motor nerve as a third cranial nerve, that is the oculomotor nerve, and this from pretectal nucleus, the fiber, they stimulate the adingal vesper nucleus of third cranial nerve, and then that fiber, they helps to execute the accommodation reflex and papillary reflex. So the incoming fiber or efferent fiber from the optic nerve, they actually first stimulate the pretectal nucleus, and from pretectal nucleus the fiber going to the adingal vesper nucleus of third cranial nerve, and from there the efferent fiber comes to the eye, and they helps to execute the accommodation reflex as well as the light reflex. Okay, so the pretectal nuclei having a role to execute different reflexes of the eye. The third, into the superior colliculus to control rapid directional movement of two eye. Now the superior colliculus not only receives the signal from the eye, but it also receives the feedback signals from the visual cortex, and accordingly they having a role to execute the saccadic movement of the eye. Now saccadic movements of the eye, they are the functional movement of the eye which are mainly occurring during the various our day-to-day functions of the eye. Means eye movement is controlled as per the different requirement of the movement of the eye. For example, during the reading, when you finish the one line and then you go to the second line, at that time your both the eye move combinedly to make your gaze focus on the beginning of second line. Okay, so that type of movement is known as the saccadic movement. And superior colliculus, they having the spatial organization of the body as well as surrounding. Okay, the same type of organization is also present in the sensory and motor cortex. So same type of spatial organization is also present in superior colliculus. So it also helps to makes the person aware about the its various part of the body as well as about the surrounding. Okay, so that is also one of the functions of superior colliculus, and it is help by the signals which are coming from visual pathways. Four, into the ventral lateral geniculate nucleus of the thalamus and surrounding basal region of the brain. Now this basal region of the brain, they are mainly a part of limbic system, a system which controls our behavior and emotions. Okay, so and that's why they presumably to help control some of the body's behavioral function. So our behavior as well as our emotions, they are depend on which type of things we are visualizing, okay, and that type of incidents or events which we are visualizing may affect us emotionally, or they may change our behavior, okay. So this thing is possible because this ventral geniculate nucleus of the thalamus, they receives the light signals from the visual pathway, and then it coordinated with the basal region of the brain. This basal region of the brain is mainly helps to control the emotions and behavior because they are considered as a part of limbic system. So here this ventral geniculate nucleus of the thalamus, they provide the connection between the this visual pathway as to the limbic system, okay, while the dorsal lateral geniculate nucleus, they are a main part of the direct visual pathway. We can say this ventral geniculate nucleus or ventral part of lateral geniculate nucleus, they are a part of accessory visual pathway, okay, while dorsal part, they are involved in the direct visual pathway. So these are the some other connection of visual pathway. One to the suprachiasmatic nuclei, which control the diurnal variation or circadian rhythm. Second is to the pretectal nuclei, which control the reflex activity such as light reflex as well as accommodation reflex. Third one is the superior colliculus, which controls the rapid directional movement of the two eye. And the fourth is the ventral lateral geniculate nucleus and the azul basal part, which provide the connection between the visual pathway and limbic cortex, which control the body's behavioral functions. Then the functions of dorsal lateral geniculate nucleus of the thalamus. So this lateral geniculate nucleus, particularly the dorsal part, they having an important role in this pathway. So we will discuss it separately. The dorsal lateral geniculate nucleus, they serves two principal functions. First, it relays visual information from the optic tract to visual cortex by way of optic radiation. The optic radiation is also known as geniculocalcarine tract. Geniculo from this geniculate nucleus, calcarine because this is a part of visual cortex. In the visual cortex, the most of the fiber from this visual pathway, they end around the calcarine sulcus. There is a one sulcus in the occipital lobe that is known as the calcarine sulcus. So according to this area, the name is given geniculocalcarine tract to the optic radiation, okay. So optic radiations, another name is geniculocalcarine tract. The second major function of dorsal lateral geniculate nucleus is to gauge the transmission of signal to visual cortex, that is to control the how much of the signal is allowed to pass to the cortex. Now this geniculate nucleus is part of the thalamus, and actually the thalamus is also known as the gatekeeper of cerebral cortex, because any incoming fiber which enter into the cerebral cortex, or any outgoing fiber from cerebral cortex to lower area, they first must pass through the thalamus, okay. So thalamus, they act as a gatekeeper, okay. So same way, this lateral geniculate nucleus is the part of the thalamus, and they are involved with the visual pathway. So they check the incoming fiber as well as the outgoing fiber, which control the vision that is checked by this lateral geniculate nucleus, particularly the dorsal part, and that's why it is known as the gate of this visual pathway, okay. The nucleus receives gating control signal from two major sources. One is known as corticofugal fiber. Cortico means coming from cortex, fugal means they are coming to this lateral geniculate nucleus, okay. So this corticofugal fiber, they are outgoing fiber from cortex to the lower area of the brain and then reticular area of mesencephalon. So this reticular area of mesencephalon, they are sending another somatic incoming fibers, okay, which is coming from other area of the brain. So this two type of fiber, they are received in the this lateral geniculate nucleus. Now the main axons which are coming from the ganglionic cells from the which form the optic nerve and then optic tract. Okay, after optic chiasma it is known as the optic tract. So this optic tract when they terminated in the lateral geniculate nucleus, because they make the synapse with the different neurons of the lateral geniculate nucleus, and then the axons of this neuron that reach up to the primary visual cortex. Okay. So there are mainly two type of fibers which are coming from ganglionic cell, and then there are mainly two type of fiber which send axons from lateral geniculate nucleus to the cortex. So from ganglionic cells to lateral geniculate nucleus there are two type of path fibers, and from lateral geniculate nucleus to visual cortex there are another two type of fibers. Okay, so the lateral geniculate nucleus is actually divided into six layer. Okay, the layer 1 and 2 are called the magnocellular layer because they contain large neuron. If you can see here, there are six layer. We have number 1 to 6. Okay, these are the layer of lateral geniculate nucleus. Out of this layer 1 and 2, they are known as magnocellular layer because they contain a large neuron. This neuron receives their input almost entirely from the type M retinal ganglionic cell. If you remember our previous lecture, then in that we had discussed about the ganglionic cells, that broadly we know about the two type of ganglionic cells. They are having the same name, magnocellular ganglionic cell or M cells, and parvocellular ganglionic cells or P cells. So the fiber from retinal M ganglionic cells, they are coming and terminated in layer 1 and 2. Okay, the signals from parvocellular is coming into the layer 3 to 6. Okay, retinal P cells, they are terminating from layer 3 to 6. Okay, layer 3 to 6 are called parvocellular layer because they contain large number of small to medium size neurons. Okay, so that neurons, they are terminated in layer 3 to 6. Now the axons of neurons which are present in layer 1 and 2 that are magnocellular, and they form the pathway between the lateral geniculate nucleus and the primary visual cortex. They form the magnocellular pathway, and the fibers which are coming from layer 3 to 6, they form the parvocellular pathway. So this further two type of division occur in optic radiation. One is magnocellular pathway, another is parvocellular pathway. Now we know that this one optic tract, they contain a two type of fiber, one which coming from opposite eye, that are the nasal fiber, some fibers or half of the fiber coming from the same eye. Okay, so here you can see that C and I. C means the fiber from contralateral eye, I means the fiber from ipsilateral, it means same side of the eye. Okay, here suppose this is our right eye. Okay, in this figure, so this is right lateral geniculate nucleus. So it contain a half of the fiber which coming from the left eye, which are the nasal fiber of the left eye and temporal fiber of right eye. Right eye, here in case it is known as ipsilateral, left fiber they are known as contralateral. So we indicated with C and I. So the fiber from ipsilateral eye, they are terminated in layer 2, 3 and 5. Okay, if you can see here that the fiber which are coming from the ipsilateral eye, here you can see that they are marked by a dotted line, and they are also indicated by I. So this fiber terminated on layer 2, 3 and 5, while the fiber which are designated by solid black line and also designated by letter C, that is coming from opposite eye or contralateral eye, they are terminated in layer 1, 4 and 6. Okay, so fiber from ipsilateral eye, they are terminated in lateral geniculate nucleus in the layer 2, 3 and 5 and fiber from contralateral eye. They are terminated in layer 1, 4 and 6. Okay. So this is how the arrangement are there, that the one side of lateral geniculate nucleus, they are actually receiving the fiber from both side of the eye. Now the lesions of visual pathway. So before that, first we see that these are the two eye, and actually these are the visual field, okay, visual field which are actually visualized by each eye. So the temporal side of any eye, they actually helps to see the nasal half of visual field, and nasal side of the retina, it helps to see the temporal half of the visual field. The reason I think we are already discussing optic of the eye, because the light rays, they are passing from the center of the lens and they focus on the focal point. So focal point, center of the lens and the object, they are in one line. Okay, so that's why our temporal visual field is focused by the nasal half of retina, and our nasal side of visual field is actually focused on the temporal half of retina. Okay, so this thing apply to both the eye. Okay, so you can see that this is the temporal half of retina which see this visual field. This is the nasal half of retina of left eye, it going to visualize temporal side of this visual field. Same way, the nasal half of right, they visualize the temporal half of this visual field, and this temporal half of right eye, they visualize the nasal half of this visual field. Now see the lesion. Suppose some damages occur. These are the four A, B, C and D. They are four different lesion at four different site. So A suggesting the damage to the left optic nerve. This one is the optic nerve. So if we damage the left optic nerve, then this showing the loss of visual field. So left side of whole visual field is lost. So we can say there will be a complete blindness in left eye. So when the damage is at site A, it causes the blindness in left eye. Now lesion in the center of optic chiasma, and optic chiasma you can see here that it only containing the nasal half of fiber from both eye. Okay, so when we cut this one nasal part is lost, this one is also lost. Okay, so this left eye is used to visualize the temporal field of left eye, so temporal half is lost. Same way, this one is damaged, so it is not able to visualize this half, that is a temporal half of right eye. So the right side temporal view is also lost. So we can say this is when the half of the visual field from each eye is lost, it is known as hemianopia. Okay, and because the both the side of temporal half is lost, we can say it a bitemporal hemianopia. So this lesion in optic chiasma, they leads to bitemporal hemianopia. Now when the lesion in optic tract, okay, so optic tract, they contain the temporal half of fiber from left eye and nasal half from right eye. So this one is damaged, so the nasal field, nasal half of left eye is damaged, this fiber is damaged, so it visualize the temporal half of right eye. So temporal side of right eye is loss. Okay, and this is known as, because here the half of the visual field of right side is lost from both the eye. Okay, this is the right side of visual field, half of the right side of the visual field is lost. So that's why the same, if and the same side of the visual field is not, that is known as the homonymous. Okay, so this is known as, because the right side of visual field is lost, we are said it right homonymous hemianopia. Same way, when the opposite half of the visual field is lost, that may be known as the heteronymous. So this bitemporal hemianopia, another name is heteronymous hemianopia. Here, because the same side of the visual field, that right side of the visual field is lost in this figure C, so that is known as the right homonymous hemianopia. Okay. Now, suppose there is a damage to the optic radiation. Okay. Then, in that case, because the optic radiation also having this same type of fiber, that ipsilateral, temporal and contralateral nasal, so same type of visual field loss is there, but here there is a one indentation you can see here compared to the C. The only difference in this figure is this indentation which you are seeing here. Okay, it is actually suggesting the macular sparing, because the macular fiber, the fiber which coming from the macula, the macula is the area of the retina where the fovea centralis is situated, which having the highest visual acuity and which are mainly for the central vision. Okay, when the pupil is maximally constricted, the all the light rays, they are mainly focusing on the fovea centralis, so they are mainly responsible for central vision. Okay. Our visual field can divided broadly into two part, the central field and peripheral visual field. Okay, so central field is mainly focused on the fovea centralis. Okay, so when this fiber from fovea centralis, or particularly the macula, they are actually terminated most posteriorly on the occipital lobe. Means they are terminated on the posterior pole of the occipital lobe, and they are quite far from the other fiber from peripheral retina. Okay, so sometime it may happen that when there is a damage in the visual cortex, or even in optic radiation, at that time it may be possible that the macular fiber may remain safe, or they may spare to damage. Okay, so macular vision remain intact, and that type of damage is known as hemianopia with macular sparing. Okay, so that is one of the another abnormality. Now if you can see that here type of deviation is there, this deviation, or it form a one type of loop. This loop is also having a significance. That loop is known as Meyer's loop. Okay, this Meyer's loop is actually carrying the fiber which is coming from the inferior temporal side of the retina, inferior part of the temporal side of the retina. Okay, and that fibers, they are actually forming a one loop, so they are somewhat separated from the rest of the optic radiation. Okay, and when particularly only some type of damage, only that fiber is damaged, then it causing the superior nasal quadrenopia. Okay, so the superior side of the nasal field is only lost in one eye, that is known as the superior nasal quadrenopia, which occur in damage to the Meyer's loop. That is not seen in this figure, but this is one of the another lesion of visual pathway. When this particular loop, that is known as Meyer's loop, if they are damaged, then that, because they are representing the fourth part of inferior temporal retina. Okay, so that's why known as quadrant. So the inferior quadrant of temporal retina is damaged, so the vision loss is superior nasal quadrant of that particular eye. Okay, so if we divide this into four part, we have here divided into two part, but if we draw one more horizontal line and divide into four part, then this upper quadrant of nasal half is lost if this loop is damaged. Okay, so that is one more lesion of visual pathway. So this is all about the visual pathway. If optic nerve is damaged, that leads to complete blindness in that particular eye. If there is a damage in optic chiasma, then it leads to bitemporal hemianopia. If there is a damage in optic tract, then it leads to the homonymous hemianopia. If leads to the visual cortex and optic radiation, then it leads to hemianopia with macular sparing. And if there is a damage in Meyer's loop, then it is known as the nasal superior quadrenopia. Okay. Now the visual cortex. So visual cortex is divided mainly into two parts: primary visual cortex and secondary visual cortex. All the incoming fibers, they are terminated around the calcaline fissure. This line is the calcaline fissure. So the incoming fibers, they are terminated on both the side of calcaline fissure. This calcaline fissure is actually situated on the medial half of the occipital lobe. This all the posterior part of the cerebral cortex is known as occipital lobe. So in the occipital lobe, in the medial side, this calcaline fissure is there, and on the both the side of calcaline fissure, the fiber from the eye, they are terminated. This whole part is known as primary visual cortex. Out of this, the macular fiber, they are terminated in the posterior most part, or we can say on the occipital lobe. From the primary visual cortex, the fiber goes into the secondary visual cortex, and that is known as secondary visual area. The primary visual area, they mainly receive the incoming signal, and they interpret the primary information. That is, it helps to see the visual signal or interpret the visual signal, but the detailed interpretation in the form of it means the image can be interpreted in detail, like its shape, its texture, its color, whether its orientation, lines, angles, the intensity of light, that means hues, the different color combinations, all these things, and the object is in motion, then that speed of the motion, direction of the motion, that is determined in the secondary visual area. And secondary visual area, they also having a connection with the somatic sense as well as with the auditory cortex also. So the overall, if we see the image simultaneously, if we touch the image, and if the if we see the object, touch the object, and simultaneously if the object sound is also coming from the object, then that it easy to identify that objects. Okay, so this detailed interpretation is mainly occur in the secondary visual area, and secondary visual area is extended in the posterior parietal cortex as well as in the this temporal part of the temporal lobe or temporal cortex also involves, where the secondary visual area is there. Okay, so that this area, temporal, occipital as well as parietal, this all area, they are included in the secondary visual area. So this thing is more easily understand by this figure, the importance of secondary visual cortex. The two major pathway for analysis of visual information: the FAST, that is the position and motion pathway, and the accurate color pathway. The FAST pathway is coming from or formed by the meganocellular pathway, which we had discussed in the lateral geniculate body, that from lateral geniculate nucleus, the two type of pathway, they coming up to the visual cortex. The pathway from layer 1 and 2 of lateral geniculate nucleus, they form the meganocellular pathway, because their cells are large, neurons are large, so their fibers are large, and their conduction is fast, and they mainly make the visual cortex aware about the position and motion. And the second is the parvocellular pathway. They having a small neurons, so their speed of conduction is less, the slow pathway, and they mainly transmit the accurate color pathway. So the color is mainly transmitted by parvocellular pathway, and they are interpreted in this visual cortex. Now if you can see here, that these black solid lines which are going into the posterior parietal cortex. The posterior parietal cortex, they having a spatial orientation of different part of the body. They mainly helps to interpret the form, the 3D image, the position and the motion of different object. Okay, so whatever the moving things and the different form of the object, they are interpreted in the this secondary visual area, which are situated in the posterior parietal cortex, and they are also having a connection with somatosensory area. The somatosensory area, which mainly interpret the tactile sensations. Okay, so that as I told you, that if we see and touch the object simultaneously, then we are more easily able to identify that object rather than only see or only touch. Okay, if we are doing both the things simultaneously, then it is easy to identify the object. Okay, the this red signals, they are coming in this another secondary visual area, that mainly helps to identify the visual detail like shape, size and color. Okay, so that helps to identify these things. Okay, so these are the difference in the interpretation. This one, they are mainly said that they are coming from this, means this type of fiber, they are actually coming from the magnocellular pathway. This type of fiber, they are interpreting the signal which are coming from parvocellular pathway. So this is how the visual cortex is interpreted. Now the layers in the visual cortex. So not only in the visual cortex, but whole cerebral cortex from outward to inside. It means from uppermost surface to inner side, if you go, they are divided into 6 layers. This same type of 6 layer, they are present in whole cerebral cortex. So this same type of layer you will learn in the somatosensory cortex, in the motor cortex, and in the other higher center of the cerebral cortex. Okay, so all the cerebral cortex having this 6 layer, from outside to inside, we designated or we have given the Roman number 1 to 6. Okay, out of this, the layer 4 is further divided into subtype AB and C alpha and C beta. Okay, now the magnocellular pathway, which are coming from lateral geniculate nucleus, they are actually terminated, or retinal M ganglionic cell, they are terminated in C alpha layer of layer 4. Okay, layer 4 sub layer is C alpha, where the magnocellular pathway is terminated, and from there the fiber going vertically upward and downward into other layers. Okay, while and this is helps to identify the form, 3D position and motion. Okay, while the fiber from parvocellular pathway, that is mainly terminated in the layer 4a as well as 4 beta, and from there the fiber going into layer vertically in upward and in the downward. Now this the fiber which are going in layer 2 and 3, they are mainly helps to interpret the color, and they are known as color blob. These layers neurons, they having a higher concentration of enzyme cytochrome oxidase, and they are known as color blobs. And these color blobs, they are mainly helps in the interpretation of the color, and these signals are very accurate and helps in the color perception. This magnocellular pathway, they are fast and they helps to interpret the black and white vision. Okay, so this is about the difference between the functions of magnocellular and parvocellular pathway, and the their termination in the visual cortex. The magnocellular, they are terminated in C alpha of layer 4. Here it is terminated in layer 4a and C beta, and from this they are going into color blobs, which are actually present, or the group of neuron which are present in layer 2 and 3 of visual cortex, and they having a higher cytochrome oxidase enzyme concentration, and they are known as color blobs. Now the neuronal pattern of stimulation during analysis of visual image. Now this one is the retinal visual image, and this one is actually how the cortical stimulation occur when we see this image. Okay, and if you can see this, the stimulation is only able to see the only lines or where the contrast is formed. Okay, what where the stimulation is uniform at that time, there is no any stimulation of cortical neuron. Okay, so this thing we had already discussed in previous lecture along with the interpretation by ganglionic cells, because the ganglionic cell having a same type of ability to stimulate, or they tend to stimulate the same type of, or they tends to feel the same type of stimulation when we see any image, that they are only able to see the things or lines where only there is any contrast. Okay, when the stimulation is uniform, at that time there is no any stimulation of the neuron. Okay, so our brain is used to interpret only the lines where contrast is formed. Okay, so this is the same type of interpretation is done by ganglionic cell as well as the neurons of cortex, visual cortex. So visual cortex, they also detects orientation of lines and borders, and they are the type of cells which detect this type of orientation. It is known as simple cells. There are more another type of cells, they are known as the complex cells. They also detects the line orientation, but only when this line is displaced laterally or vertically. Okay, so simple cells, they detect the orientation of lines and border. The complex cells also detects the orientation of line and border, but when these lines, they are moves or display laterally or vertically. So whenever these lines and border, they are in the motion, at that time there will be a role of complex cells, and when these lines and border, they are standstill, at that time the roles of simple cells are there. So these are another type of neural processing or neural analysis, that they are actually only seeing the border where the contrast is formed. Okay, otherwise when the neuronal stimulation is uniform, then there will be no any stimulation is there. So the same type of stimulation is occur in ganglionic cells also, the same type of stimulation is occur in visual cortex also. One more thing about this magnocellular pathway, that it also having the ability to differentiate the flicker, and accordingly there is a one terminology is there, that is known as the critical fusion frequency. The critical fusion frequency is the frequency at which we can able to see the two separate images. Okay, if the images is moving faster than the critical fusion frequency, then we are actually seeing the image as a continuous, or movement as a continuous. Below the critical fusion frequency, we can differentiate them as a separate. Okay, and that is known as the flicker, ability to identify the flicker. And this same thing is occur during in the projection of the movie. Okay, when, because the projector is running faster than or speed higher than the critical fusion frequency, because of that we are seeing the movie as a continuous picture. Okay, suppose the because of any defect the projector speed is decreased than the critical fusion frequency, then that picture is coming in the broken part. Okay, so they are coming as a interrupted picture. Okay, so we feel that the not the picture is continuous or the movie is going continuous, but there is a part or the in between there is a stoppage is there, or interruption are there. Okay, so that is because the whenever our movement is below the critical fusion frequency, that is the ability of the brain to identify the flicker, or ability of the brain to identify the two moving thing as a separate, that is known as the critical fusion frequency. And when it is beyond when anything is move beyond this critical fusion frequency, we see that visual field or visual image as a continuous process. Okay, so this is about the, and that is the functions of visual area which are receiving the signal from magnocellular pathway. So this is all about the visual pathway and its interpretation. Thank you.